Yes.
I'm fascinated by the background. What is it behind you?
I have no idea. It's something in the Zoom. You can also do, make it.
Oh, it's nothing to do with the zoo, nothing to do with your house.
No. It's a Zoom.
Ah, okay. No, I thought maybe it was a some it's amazing, it's fascinating.
I can change the background in the Zoom. You can change it.
No. I'm just wondering. I just thought maybe it was something on your wall there.
No, if you want,
Don't get
I
distracted.
can put a picture of Rav Kook. You see there?
Whatever you like.
Yeah, I can put San Francisco. Can put the moon. Okay, so let's
You've got an Australian picture?
you can put any picture you want.
Satellite picture.
A satellite.
Anyone, Harry?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so we're in page 67. Amar Rav Huna, three words from page 66. Amar Rav Huna, now there's some remedies here for some illnesses, but Marshall and also the Geonim said not to try it at home. It's not for us. Even the Rambam says that in his times, some of these things were known not to be proper medicine, but in those times of the Gemara, they believe that this these things cure. So, le'eshta tilta, this is I understand from Rashi, it's fever that comes once every 3 days. Shachefet shlishit. So what's the remedy? Leiti shiv'a silve mishiv'a diklei. Take seven small branches from seven palm trees. Ve'shiv'at tzive mishiv'a kshurei. Seven splinters from seven beams. Ve'shiv'a sike mishiv'a kshurei. Seven pegs from seven bridges. Ve'shiv'a ktime mishiv'a tanurei. Seven measures of ashes from seven ovens. Ve'shiv'a afre mishiv'a sinrei. Seven earth from the threshold, seven thresholds. Ve'shiv'a kufre mishiv'a arbei. And seven measures of zefet, pitch, from seven ships. Ve'shiv'a bonei kamunei. Ve'shiv'a binei midikna dechalbasava. And seven hairs from the beard of an old dog. And put it like a necklace on your throat with the hair of an animal, and that's gonna cure it. Okay, Amar Rabbi Yochanan le'eshta tzmirta. That's another type of fever. Lishkol sakina dechula parzela. Take a knife made entirely of iron. Even the handle is a metal handle. Vordina. Go to a place where there's the bush known as Vordina. That's the sneh. I'm not sure the English, what's the English term for sneh? But anyway, the idea is to go and slowly cut it a little bit every day. Veliktar be nira barka and tie to it hair of an animal. Ve yoma kama lichok be pota. On the first day, try to cut a little bit. Make a small thing. Veleima and say the verse, Vayera malach Hashem elav. The angel of Hashem was seen to him in the fire from the sneh. Lemachar lichok pepota, the following day, also try to cut a little bit and say another verse. Veleima vayomer Moshe asur ana ve'ereh. Lemachar lichok pepota, veleima vayar Hashem kisar lirot. So gradually to try to finally cut it off, and that will cut off the disease. But then, but the verses that one has to say there, Velema, the question is, why not say, Vayar Hashem, Kisar Lirot? Hashem saw that he came. So therefore, I'm sorry, Amar Le Rav Acha Brei D'Rava Le Rav Ashi, Velema, Vayomer Al Tikrav Alom. That's sounds like an appropriate verse. Don't approach, don't get close. So, Ela, Layoma Kam, on the first day, you should say two verses, Leima Vayram Alach Hashem Ela, Vayomer Moshe, ולמחר לימה וירא השם כי שר לראות ולמחר ויאמר אל תקרב הלום So 3 days, each day makes a small cut. Vechipasakle, when he finally cuts it totally, litate velifshake, he should lower it and cut it as low as possible, close to the ground. Velei ma'achi, and say as follows, asne asne, love mishum de gviat mikol ilane, it's not because you're taller than all other trees. Asher HaKadosh Baruch Hu Shechinatei Alach, Hashem put his divine presence on you. Ela mishum de mayachta mikol ilane, just because you are lower than all other trees. Asher HaKadosh Baruch Hu Shechinatei Alach, Hashem had his divine presence rest on you. V'chiyeichi dechamitei eshta, just like the fire saw. L'chananya mishael v'azariya v'arikat ben kadamoy, and went away from them. So too, ken techminei eshta liflani barplanit, so too the fire will see so and so, the sick person, v'tiarok min kadamoy, and will go away from him. That's the remedy for that type of fever. Okay, le'simta, simta is, what's that, simta? Shchin, not sure what, maybe boils, maybe? Boils. For that, le'ma'ach, you should say, whatever, something, baz, something meaningless. Baz bazia mas masia kas kasia sharlai va amarlai eli malachei de ishtalchu me'ara destom ulasa'a shchina ke'evin bazach bazich bazbezich masmesich kamun kamich inich bich einach bich at rechbach zarich kekalut ufirda delo para velo ravia kach lo tifre velo tirbe beguf et diflani bar plonit. It's I'm not sure how you call this something you say for a sick person. Anyway, that's what they said. That was the medicine of those times. Le kippa. Kippa, Rashi says, either also a type of boils or somebody was seized by a demon. So what should you say against it? How do you call it?
Blisters.
Blisters. Could be blisters. So le ma'achi, cherev shlufa vekela netusha. Lo shmei yochav chulin machovin. No? That's the thing you have to say. And then l'sheida, if you encounter a demon or if a demon caused you any damage, you should say leima achi havit defakik defakik havit lita tavur meshumat bar tit bar tamer bar tina keshamgaz merigaz veistamai. That's the thing to say. They told me that they have such a thing in Harry Potter. He also says some things against the witch. But in those times, it was actually incantations. Okay, thank you. It's an incantation. Lesheida deveta kisen, a special demon of the a lavatory demon. Leimaachi akarkafei de ari de'apusay de guraita, on the head of the male lion and the nose of the lioness. Ashkachtun leshidai bar shirika fanda b'meishra dechartei chavtei. And that will drive away that demon. Okay, that was the thing. Uvnei melachim bezagin. Now, princes, according to the Mishnah, can go out on Shabbat in the public domain with bells, golden bells. And the Mishnah says not only princes, but even anyone. Just the Mishnah spoke, and the common thing was that the princes had such expensive, fancy golden bells. Now, man Tana, who is the Tana who said that all Jews can go out with that? So, Amar Rabbi Oshaya, Rabbi Shimoni, that's Rabbi Shimon, the Amar, Kol Israel b'nei melachim. He says later in this tractate that all Jews are like princes. So, even poor people, it's not considered like not befitting, that doesn't fit his position. Every Jew is like a son of a king, and it such a golden belt befits any Jew. The Rava says no, it's there's no dispute. The Mishnah refers to such a belt that is attached, it's woven with a garment, embroidered with a garment, so there's no concern. It's impossible to remove it. And anything that it's impossible to remove, there's no prohibition to go with to the public domain. The only decree is because of the concern that one might remove the the jewel and show it to anyone. If it's attached to the garment, there's no problem. And finally, we got to the last mission of this chapter that speaks about something like an amulet. Yotzin beveitzat hachargol. One can go out on Shabbat while he's carrying an egg of a grasshopper. That's a remedy for something. It's like an amulet that cures. The Gemara explains what illness it can cure. And just like an amulet is permitted, so to this. Now the Rambam himself writes in the book Moreh Nevuchim, his words imply that in his times, this was not known to be something of any medical advantage. There's no cure, does not cure. But he said that since in the time of the Mishnah, it was a known remedy, it was known to cure the some kind of an illness. So therefore, just like an amulet, anything that cures, you can go out with Shabbat, on Shabbat with. And also, there's no problem of following the ways of the nations, what's called the Chukot HaEmori, Chukot HaGoyim, Darchei HaEmori, because anything that is known to be effective, there's no problem with that. So that's why the Mishnah says, Yotzin beveitzat hachargol, the egg of the grasshopper, veshen shel shu'al, a tooth of a fox, ובמסמר מן הצלב, also a nail from, taken from a person who was צלוב, crossed, right? So, crucified, right. משום רפואה, דברי רבי מאיר, so that's a remedy, and you can take it on Shabbat just like an amulet. וחכמים אוסרים אף בכל, the sages prohibit this even during the week, משום דרכי האמורי, because it's the prohibition of not to follow the ways of the Amorites, which included some matters of idol worship and some matters of nonsense. And the sages say that this is one of those ways that are forbidden to us. But halacha is that it's permitted. And even the Rambam, who himself did not even, in his times it was known that it does not cure, he bring this down to halacha. In his halachic book, the Rambam brings this thing. Even though he himself says it does not cure in his time. So since it was known to be effective in the time of the Mishnah, says, okay, that's according to their knowledge, that was a good remedy, so you can do it. And now the Gemara explains what's the illnesses that these are remedies for. Yotzin beveitzat hachargol, the grasshopper egg, what is it good for? The avdei leshichla. That's good against the earache. So the they hang it in the ear. The beshenchen shel shu'al, a fox tooth, the avdei leshenta. That's good for sleeping problems. Some people have a problem that they cannot sleep. Some people have a problem that they sleep too much. So you take either the chaya lemandenaim, you take a tooth from a live fox, and that's good for a person who sleeps too much. That will wake him up. If a person has a problem falling asleep, you take a tooth from a dead fox, and that will cause him to fall asleep. Yeah. I'm not sure, what about the Fox News? Does that wake you up, or does it put you to sleep? This is a fox tooth, it's something else. A nail from a crucified one, the avdei lazirfa. That's good against, as she says, nefach makah. I'm not sure if there's maybe pus or maybe something that cures that. You need some connections with the crucifier to get the nail. It's not so simple. But if you have those connections, that can cure. Now, mishum refuah divrei Rabbi Meir, Abaye v'Rava, the Amri Tarvayu, both said, kol davar sheyesh bo mishum refuah, אין בו משום דרכי האמורי. Even though the Torah forbade us to follow the ways of the Amorites, the prohibition does not apply to something that is known to be effective in healing, in curing. And actually the Maharik, Tshuvat Maharik, expands this and says that the prohibition does not apply to anything that makes sense. And that's why he was asked, is a Jewish doctor permitted to wear a robe like a non-Jewish doctor? Is this a problem of following the ways of the non-Jew, of the Amorites, of the idol worshippers? So he said that anything that makes sense, there's no problem in us behaving like them or acting like them. The problem is only in things that either do not make sense or things that bring about promiscuity or bad things. So if there's something
so
known
to
be,
the reasoning?
What?
What's the reasoning of Rabbi Meir, who says that you can't do this?
No, Rabbi Meir actually permits it. The sages prohibit it in the Mishnah. The sages prohibit it. Actually, you're right. There is a version in the Yerushalmi that Rabbi Meir is the one who prohibits it. It seems like he did not believe in that remedy. He says it doesn't cure.
My question was the opposite, because Rabbi Meir permits it. He says that there's no problem from Dalkei Mori. How does he explain that?
So exactly as Abaye and Rava say. Abaye and Rava also say that anything that is known to be effective, if it's known to be an effective remedy, there's no problem in doing it. The Torah forbade us. What?
So basically the problem is like the first few times till it becomes known, then it's Dalkei Mori till it's not.
So those who start it must be the Gentiles. If they start it and they find it to be effective, so then we can also use it. But if it's not yet established as an effective remedy, so we shouldn't follow their ways. But if it's a known remedy, if it's medically proven to be effective, so no problem. Okay, but now the question is, en bo mishum refuah, anything that is not effective, not known to be effective, yesh bo mishum darchei emori, is that forbidden to us? How come there's a brayta that apparently permits to do something which does not make sense, does not have any reasoning? Ve'atanya, it says about ilan shemashir pirutav, what if a person has a problem with a tree that the fruits of that tree just fall off the tree? So what can person do about that? So krobesikra, first you can dye it with red dye, ve toano beavanim, and put a lot of stones on that tree. Now these two acts, one of them is reasonable. Bishlama toano beavanim, to load it with the stones, that's reasonable. Keichid elichosh chayle, because it makes sense that the reason the fruits fall off from that tree is because the tree has too much power, it's too strong. So if you load it with stones, it weakens the tree and will prevent the fruits from ripe too soon and fall off the tree. But the question is, ela sokro besikra, to dye it with red dyes looks like a superstitious. How come the Braita permits that? What kind of a remedy is that? Red dye helps the tree recover. So the answer is that this also it's something reasonable. There is a reason for it. So that people will see that red dye and they'll know that there's a problem about this tree and they'll pray for the tree to recover. So it's to publicize the problem. That's why it's permitted. Anything that makes sense is permitted. Kedetanya, as the Braita says, that the Torah has that concept in case of a person afflicted with tzarat. Tameh yikra. That's what the Torah says about metzorah. Whenever he goes and he encounters any person, he should call out, tameh, tameh, I'm tameh. Why does he have to scream that he is tameh? Tzarich lo'odia tzaro le'rabim. He must publicize his trouble. The rabim yevakshu alav rachamim, and they will pray for him. So that's the purpose of putting this red dye on that tree. It's a reasonable thing. Okay, Amar Avina, keman talinan kubasei bedikla ki aitana. There was a custom in Babylonia that in case of a palm tree that had a problem, also that the dates fell from the tree, you used to hang on it a cluster of dates. So that's like this baita, that the purpose was to publicize the problem of the tree so people can pray for it and help recover. Okay. Tani tana beferek emorae kamei de Rabbi Chiya bar Avin. Now there's a chapter in the Tosefta, in this tractate, that deals with this prohibition of following the ways of the Amorites. And there are many, many things that are mentioned there, different things that the Gentiles used to do. So some of them were permitted, some of them are forbidden. So the Tana said that chapter before Rabbi Chiya bar Ravin, so he told him, Amar lei, kulu itbu mishum darchei Amori. All the things that are mentioned there are forbidden to us. They are the ways of the Amorites, we should not follow them, except for two of them. Levar mehani. Mi sheyesh lo etzem bigrono. If somebody ate something and the bone is stuck in his throat, so mevim oto amin umaniach le'al kod kodosh, should bring that type of food, whatever he ate, if it was a fish or a chicken or whatever he ate, and he puts it on his forehead, on his head, ve'lei ma'achim, should say the following thing, chad chad nachit bala bala nachit chad chad. So this remedy, en bo mishum darchei ha'emorim, this you can do because this was known to be effective. That was a known remedy for to get rid of a bone stuck in the throat. And also le'adra, if it's a fish bone that's in the person's esophagus, le'ma'achi should say as follows: nin'atzta kemachat, nin'alta ketris, shaya shaya. That's what you have to say. This reminds me a story about once in Bnei Brak. There was a child that swallowed a coin, and his mother was so terrified, she took him and she ran to the Chazon Ish, and there were people waiting there in the outside, but she didn't care. She pushed in, she opened the door and screamed, "My son swallowed a coin." So the Chazon Ish was sitting there. So he said, and other people in the room, he said, "Okay, so I can't do anything about it, but take him to Rav Kahaneman." Says Rav Kahaneman has the ability to take money out of any person. So he can get that out of him. So then people started to laugh. When they started to laugh, the child also started to laugh, and the coin went out of his mouth. So there are other ways to extract coins from or things from people's throats. Okay, now in 67b, Ha'omer gad gadi v'sanuk lo ashri uvushri. Somebody says, I have a good luck, let my luck not become tired day and night. That statement that apparently non-Jews used to say every now and then. Yesh pa mishum darchei ha'emori. That's for Jews. There's a prohibition to say that. Rabbi Yehuda omer, God, the word God, eino ela leshon avodah zara. It connotes idolatry. Sheneemar ha'orchim legad shulchan. So that's a problem. Hu bishma vehi bishmo. There used to be people that at night they used to exchange their names, the couple. He would call her by his name and she would call him by her name. So yesh pa mishum darchei ha'emori. That's a idolatrous practice. Dunu dana, if one says, let my barrels strengthen, yesh pa mishum darchei ha'emori. That's in the ways of the Amorites. Rabbi Yehuda omer, ein dan ela lashon avodah zarah. Dan also connotes idolatry, sheneemar, as the verse says in Amos, hanishbaim be'ashmat shomron ve'amru chei Elohecha dan. So it speaks about the name of an idol, dan. Ha'omer le'orev tzrach. If there's a raven that makes a sound and he says to him, scream, because the way a raven will bring him good tidings, ve'la'or v'tashriki, and to a female raven. Also, he says that, ve'achzir eliz navech letovah, return your tail to me for good, yesh po mishum darchei ha'emori. So that was, used to be a superstitious of the non-Jews.
So basically we're saying that anything that has no logic in it is darchei ha'emori.
Right.
Right? So basically, and Rabbi Meir says that anything that is tested and proven is not darchei ha'emori.
I think all believe in that. All agree that if something is known to be effective, a remedy or a cure, you can do it. I think that the dispute in the Mishnah is about the reality. Are these things indeed effective? The sages say that such a fox tooth or a nail from a crucified is not effective. And Tanakama says it's effective. So that's a dispute. There's no dispute about the concept. The concept, the principle that anything that is known to be effective, a good remedy, the Torah did not forbid it.
So It's about the details.
Yeah. אומר שחטו תרנגול זה שקרא ערבית. If one rooster was later than his fellows, or Rashi says he called out like a raven, he made a sound like a raven. So somebody says, okay, you have to slaughter it. ותרנגולת שקרא גברית, or if a female hen made a voice like a male, and that's a reason to slaughter it. יש פה משום דרכי האמורי, but nevertheless Jews still believed in that if a rooster or a hen make a different sound, you have to slaughter it, don't let it stay. They used to do it. אשתה ואותיר, if somebody says I'll drink and leave some in the cup to have blessing, אשתה ואותיר, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי, that's the ways of the Amorites. המבקעת ביצים בכותל. Another verse is that she is hanging on the wall the shells of eggs in front of the chicks so that the chicks will not die. If that's what she does, בפני האפרוחים, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי. והמגיס בפני האפרוחים, if one stirs the pot intentionally before the chicks, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי. המרקדת, if she dances, והמונה 71 אפרוחים, and counts 71 chicks, בשביל שלא ימותו for them not to die, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי. המרקדת לקוטח, if a woman prepares this dish, קוטח, and she dances for the dish to be better, והמשתקת לעדשים, or when she is cooking lentils, right? She says everybody must be silent. והמצווחת לגריסין, or she cooks גריסין, that's what גריסין, anyway, she cooks that, she says, she screams, she thinks it's gonna help the dish be better, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי, that's forbidden. המשתנת בפני קדירתה, if she urinates before the pot, בשביל שתתבשל מהרה, so that it will cook quicker, יש פה משום דרכי האמורי. However, one thing is permitted, אבל נותנים קיסם של תות. You can put the splinter of תות. תות is like a strawberry, maybe. You can put there in the dish, that hastens the cooking. ושברי זכוכית, or broken glass. בקדירה, בשביל שתתבשל מהרה, because that indeed is effective in hastening the cooking. וחכמים אוסרים בשברי זכוכית מפני שהסכנה. The sages prohibit to add a broken glass to the dish because it's dangerous. But they also agree that it's effective in hastening cooking. Okay, תנו רבנן, נותנים בול של מלח לתוך הנר. One is permitted to put a handful of salt into the lamp בשביל שתאיר ותדליק. Because the salt, it's not something superstitious, it's physically, it actually works, because it the salt causes the oil to be clear and causes it to light better, so that's permitted. ונותנים תית וחרסית תחת הנר, you can put תית, that's what's that, cement, not cement, וחרסית תחת הנר.
Mud.
Okay. You can put mud under the lamp, בשביל שתמתין את הדליק, so that it will slow down the and it will not burn so quickly. And since we mentioned that, so now there's a statement about not wasting energy. אמר רב זוטרא, אמר זוטרא, היימן דמיכסי שרגא דמישחא. If one has a lamp that burns on oil, and he covers it, if you cover that, it hastens the burning of the oil, so it's a waste. ומגלה נפטה, if you have a נפטה lamp, and you uncover it, it also burns more quickly, and it's a waste of energy, because why let it burn quickly if it can burn slower? So כעבר משום בל תשחית, he's violating the prohibition of בל תשחית, not to destroy a good thing, not to waste. Many poskim say that it's only a rabbinic prohibition, it's not a biblical. The biblical prohibition of bal tashchit only applies to fruit-bearing trees, The Torah says, "Lo tashchit et eitza," do not destroy the tree. But other things, there's not a biblical prohibition, but a rabbinic prohibition not to waste or not to destroy. Chamra v'chayei lefum rabbanan, en bo mishum darchei ha'emori. When they pour a cup of wine, they say l'chaim. I think this might be the source. Chamra, they used to say chamra v'chayei, wine and life to the mouth of the sages. So no problem to say that. And there was actually an incident, Ma'aseh be'Rabbi Akiva, she'asam mishtel livno, he married off his son, ve'al kol kos v'chos she'aviv, for every cup of wine that he brought, amar chamra v'chayei lefum rabbanan, wine and life to the mouth of the sages, chayei v'chamra, life and wine, lefum rabbanan, to the mouth of the sages, lefum talmideon, and to the mouths of their disciples. So that's a blessing. It's a nice blessing to say, l'chaim. Yeah, adran alach v'meisha, adran alach v'meisha, adran alach v'meisha. So we can still have time to start the next chapter, which now goes into a halachic mode. And the first Mishnah is dealing with the liability to bring a chatat offering for desecrating Shabbat inadvertently. Now, a condition to be inadvertent means that the person knew about the prohibition and then forgot it, and then remember it again. At the time he committed the act, when he performed the labor, he forgot something. Either he forgot that today is Shabbat, and that's why he did this labor, or he could forget that this labor is forbidden. He remembered it's Shabbat today, but let's say he forgot that there's a prohibition to write two letters on Shabbat. So that's also inadvertent. For that one is liable to chatat. But the Mishnah says that the principle is that the chatat liability is one chatat per each forgetfulness. So if you forget one thing, and that one forgetfulness causes you to make even many labors, so the chatat is only one chatat. For each thing you forget, you bring a chatat. And just one thing, and that forgetfulness caused him to make many, many labors, and he's only liable to one chatat. And that's the first case the Mishnah brings. Klal gadol amru b'Shabbat, a big general rule they said in Shabbat. Kol ha-shocheach ikar Shabbat. If a person forgot about the principle of Shabbat, and the Gemara explains, how could that be? A classic case could be a tinok shenishba, a Jewish child who was captured among the nations, and he did not know about the concept of Shabbat, or he forgot all about it. And because he forgot it, he did not know about that. So of course, the asam melachot arbe b'shabbatot arbe. He performed many labors on many Shabbatot, but all these acts were caused by one forgetfulness. He forgot one thing, forgot the concept of Shabbat. So because it's one forgetfulness, one thing he forgot, eino chayav ela chatat achat. He's only liable to bring one chatat for all these labors and all these Shabbatot that he desecrated. Hayodea ikar Shabbat, if one knows about the principle of Shabbat, ve'asa melachot arbe b'shabbatot arbe, now this is a case of a person who forgot, he knows the concept, but when the day of Shabbat arrived, he forgot that today is Shabbat. He thought that it was a Sunday or a Friday. So even though he did many labors on that Shabbat, but since it's one forgetfulness, one thing he forgot that caused him to do all these labors, he forgot that today is Shabbat. So he also is liable for one chatat for every Shabbat he forgot. Chayav al kol Shabbat v'Shabbat. For each and every Shabbat, he's liable for chatat, regardless of the number of labors he performed on that Shabbat. And finally, the Mishnah speaks about the person who knows that today is Shabbat, and he just forgot one specific labor. Hayodea shehu Shabbat. So he knows the concept of Shabbat. He knows that today is Shabbat. Ve'asa melachot arbe b'Shabbatot arbe. And he committed many labors on that day. So the reason, of course, he committed these labors inadvertently is because he forgot that each specific labor is forbidden. And here, for each thing he forgot, he's liable to chatat. So chayav al kol av melacha melacha, for each and every primary melacha, av melacha, he's liable to chatat. So you can have two people, they both committed, let's say, two labors on one Shabbat. One of them is liable to one chatat, and the other one is liable to two chatat. Because the one who forgot that today is Shabbat, he is liable to only one chatat for all the labors he performed on that Shabbat. But the one who remembered it was Shabbat, but he forgot about these two specific labors, So for each and every labor he forgot, he's liable to a different chatat. And then the Mishnah says at the end, if one performs many labors, but they all belong to the same category, so then he's liable to one chatat. So if you perform, the Yerushalmi says that each and every one of the 39 primary melachot has 39 secondary melachot. So you can have 39 labors that are of the same origin, the same principle. So there's one chatat liability for all of them. Okay, to be continued.
Can I have a question?
Sure.
We have before the story of the alachadon to call on a tree in red, and that people should pray for him. And okay. Makes.